Good morning.
Good morning.
So if I wasn't nervous before, when you walk in a room and your major professor and your first stats professor are sitting in the room, you sort of go, start shaking in your knees, is there going to be a grade at the end of my presentation? So I'll catch them off to the side and see how I did. I'm delighted that Lyle invited me to talk about what to teach, and thanks JP for stepping in for Lyle and to join my distinguished colleagues, Donna Riley and Karl Smith, and I should also say both of them I consider dear friends and advisors. So I'm gonna take this from the approach of, JP mentioned the past approaches based on SPEE and ASEE with regards to science and practice in the 1890s, and then we added soft skills. This graph I like, it comes from CDIO, which is an initiative, sort of an international initiative on problem-based learning, conceiving, designing, implementing, and operating. And so they've chronicled this as back in the 1950s, we were looking at pre-practice. We then moved from pre-practice down to science and practice, and then sort of more focused on science as it moved towards our disciplinary knowledge, moving away from personal and interpersonal and system building. And I wanna make sure we note system building, because at the end I'm gonna make a good connection there. But about 2000, CDIO felt like we needed to take a turn from more focus for engineers on disciplinary knowledge and start moving back towards the personal and interpersonal and system building. And I think that's congruent with what JP said when we added soft skills in 2000. So just kind of keep that in mind. But when we look at ABET, and we're not here to debate whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, it's just what it is today, and this comes from the 2017-18 criteria, what is ABET criterion outcomes expecting us to cover in the classroom? They're expecting us to cover some math and science, they're expecting us to cover some engineering, they're expecting us to cover general education, they're expecting us to cover soft skills, and they're expecting us to wrap it all up and put it in a bow around our capstone design experience, right? And so they're not telling us specifically what to teach, they're just giving us thematic areas and some minimum recommendations on how much we should be teaching. Well, with our current approach to problem solving, what we've basically been doing is looking at it from a traditional scientific approach, which separates everything into these individual pieces. And so we look at math and science, we look at physics, we look at chemistry, we look at engineering, and they're all sort of separated off. Now, we've had lots of discussion lately about discipline-based engineering research and how we need to come together and form this STEM-DeBeer alliance, and that's been moving forward, but we're still coming at it very siloed, right? So we're still looking at it from our own individual perspectives. That worked pretty well in the 20th century. When you think about the things that we accomplished in the 20th century, we did some pretty phenomenal things. Electricity, cars, people on the moon, telephones, etc. So for those types of problems, that approach worked. My hypothesis is that as we go forward to the future, that is not going to be sufficient. We're going to have to do some things very differently. When we look to the future, and I Googled this a while ago and found this article from Fast Future Publishing. What are the future jobs out in 2030? What do some of the titles look like? Body part maker. GM, which stands for genetically made, or recumbent farmer. So not only crops, but also perhaps people. Memory augmentation surgeons. New science ethicists. Space pilots and tour guides. So, you know, Elon Musk is trying to give us trips out of outer space, and now you're going to need a tour guide who can help you point out what you're seeing when you're doing such. Vertical farmers. We're not going to be growing acres and acres and acres spread out of food anymore. We're going to be growing going up because we're running out of space. There was an expose on 60 Minutes about 2 months ago that talked about growing in the lab and growing food in the lab out of dirt. So being able to simulate what the environment would look like in the ground for growing food and then replicating that in the lab. And then climate change reverse specialist. Mm. So in order for us to have those types of jobs, we need to have a different type of skill set amongst the people that we're producing. Now we've all heard about the I and the T. Now we're talking about the M-shaped person, the pie-shaped person, the cone-shaped person, right? So the thing, there's now an E-shaped person. So there's all these different looks at what type of skills people need. The moral of the story is we need more than one discipline. We need multiple disciplines that must be connected in some way as we think about who we're going to educate. So when we think about the problems that the students that we're teaching are going to be solving, we all know about the NAE, right? The NAE Grand Challenges. Many of us are reorganizing our curriculum around Grand Challenges. We have a whole Grand Challenges program and initiative, right? So Nobel Prize winner Richard Smalley also advocated for the 10 problems facing humanity in the next 50 years. And some of those same problems are energy, water, food, environment, poverty, terrorism, et cetera. So the same things that are on the NAE list. These types of problems are not problems that we're used to seeing. They're not what we would call TANG problems. TANG problems are low definition, low technical challenge, run-of-the-mill problem. The conveyor belt at the grocery store is not working, I gotta solve that. That's a TANG problem, right? We're talking about the types of problems that these students are gonna be facing are gonna be both high in technical challenge and high in definition. They're gonna be what we call wicked mess problems, right? So we've been talking about wicked problems sort of emerged in 1973, but we really haven't embraced that notion that the types of problems have no answer in the back of the book. So when Professor Richards gave us stat problems to do in class, we could get an answer in the back of the book. These problems are not going to have solutions in the back of the book. So students are going to have to bring a different approach to how they solve the problem. So when we look at wicked problems, each problem is unique and part of a web of problems, innumerable potential solutions. There's no end state and no right or wrong answer. Then we look at what we call social mess problems. And those are sort of the human interactions are inherently messy. There's going to be this endless array of interdependent variable constraints, lots of uncertainties, conflicting viewpoints and values. And we're still teaching this very linear approach to how we're going to solve these chaotic problems. So those of you who know me know I love quotes. So this one comes from former Secretary of Education Richard Riley. We must prepare students for jobs that don't yet exist, using technologies that haven't yet been invented in order to solve problems we don't even know yet are problems, right? So that's the reality of what we're looking for. So my reality is, it's time for us to get our heads out of the sand. We just can't keep thinking that this problem is gonna get solved if we keep doing the same old stuff. We're gonna have to do some things very differently. Another quote from Jim Duderstadt, who happens to be a former dean of engineering and former president of the University of Michigan, is, most of our universities are attempting to produce 21st century engineers with a 20th century curriculum in 19th century institutions. So I would challenge you, as you're building new buildings and designing new classrooms, are you just designing the same thing you've already got? A room with 20 chairs, 30 chairs, and a board? I mean, we don't even have chalk anymore. Right? So what kind of classrooms are we designing? That's another whole conversation. Spencer and Moeller in 2013 had a number of issues facing engineering. I grayed out the first four. The main one is that our educational approaches are stale and need updating. So I submit to you, as we talk about what it is we need to teach, that we probably do still need a mixture of the things that ABET says. We need some basic engineering courses, some soft skills, some gen ed, some math and science, and capstone design. But we also need to add a series of other things. We need to add making and doing. Nowadays, people can get engineering degrees without ever picking up a tool. When I went to college as an undergrad, we had a whole machine shop class. Every mechanical engineer took a machine shop class. You went in and you learned how to work a lathe, a bandsaw, a drill, sanding device, etc. If you got a B or better in the class, any time you wanted to go to the machine shop, you could go make anything you wanted to make. Well, we're doing that now in maker spaces, right? But not every school has one. So we need to really focus on making and doing. We need to focus on decision making. There's a lot of tools and theories out there around decision making. And we're not teaching engineering students, by and large, about decision making. Some disciplines are, but the vast majority of them are not. How do we make decisions around with risk and uncertainty? And there's a whole field out there about that looks at risk and uncertainty in decision making. AR/VR is coming. So I live in Norfolk, Virginia. Our biggest employer in the region is Newport News Shipbuilding. And I was over a couple weeks ago on a tour, and they're now talking about digital ship design. They are no longer gonna make big blueprints on how to make these naval carriers. They're doing it all on iPads and digitally. And so what they're saying is, for the next workforce, you're going to need to be able to get put a head device on and see behind the wall what's going on in a ship and how we're going to design and repair the ship without physically having a blueprint. And that's a whole new way of thinking about design and building. We also need to talk about diversity, and Donna's going to talk about that when she comes up. But the last area I really want to hit home is systems thinking. And if you'd have told me in 1991, when I got my master's degree in systems engineering from the University of Virginia, that I would ever really make a connection with what I learned back then to anything I was doing going forward, I would have told you no. But today I stand before you telling you that systems engineering is the thing that we really need to integrate across our engineering curriculum. And I want to share with you why. So systems engineering is the ability to see the world as a complex system in which we understand that you cannot just do one thing and that everything is connected to everything else. That comes from Sturman. It's also viewing problems as parts of an overall system rather than reacting to a specific part, outcomes, or events. And the techniques can be used to study any kind of system, a natural system, a scientific system, an engineered, human, or conceptual system. And when you go back and you think about what CDIO chronicled way back pre-50s, and the types of problems, wicked, that students are going to be solving, to me, in my humble opinion, systems thinking is the thing that we need to be teaching all engineering students to bring all of that home. So, if you're a visual learner, if you think about it from this way, if you take a green yarn, a blue yarn, a yellow yarn, a light blue yarn, and you just have yarn, you just got a bunch of pieces of yarn. There are a bunch of individual siloed pieces that apart look like nothing. But when you weave them all together, they produce this beautiful, almost finished image, right? It's the same thing with our problem solving. So we're talking about moving from this disconnected notion to interconnectedness, from linear thinking to circular thinking, from silos to emergence. We're talking about going from analysis to synthesis. We're talking about going from parts to whole. We're talking about going from isolation to relationships. And that's all of the tools that are a part of systems engineering. And there are some tools, systems thinking. And there are some tools, systems mapping, systems dynamics, which was developed at MIT, that looks at what we're doing there. So I really think the crux of the talk for me is, in terms of what to teach, we're never going to get rid of the basics, right? Because you really can't even get into systems thinking if you haven't introduced some of the basic math and physics and so forth. But we need to add, in a very significant way, this new area that we're going into. The other thing I think we need to think about with regards to what to teach is this notion of citizen engineer. And so one of the things that we did when I was at Virginia Tech, we had a grant from NSF to look at how we embrace some of the research-based instructional strategies, but then also looking at what the non-engineer might need to know. And so we had a grant from NSF to do that. And as we concluded our work, we realized we needed to develop a course called Citizen Engineer. And so I was pleased that, I think in my fourth year as department chair, I was able to attract this really talented, dynamic, high-energy professor, none other than Donna Riley, to join us at Virginia Tech and to take this course and give life to it. And so what we tried to do in that course was to introduce what is engineering, what is making, what's the role of engineering with regards to technology and society, and then wrap that up in a case study for the non-engineering students. And so we were able to do that in a way that begins to prepare the next generation of leaders that are outside of the technical realm, the engineering world, which has a direct relationship to things that we're going to need. So when we're going to need funding to design some of the things and build some of the things that we have to do, we have no one right now who really understands what it is we do and why we need the money for that. So if we take some time as a part of a gen ed requirement to offer a citizen engineer type course, I think that goes a long way towards priming the pump for down the road future requests that we're going to have to make, future policies that we're going to have to make. So Elon Musk and others are talking about being able to fly us around. So instead of taking Uber on street, you go take Uber in the air. You know, they're talking about all these different kind of pods that you can go out on the corner and a little Jetson-like car will come and pick you up and take you where you have to go. But there are going to be a lot of policy implications for that. And if you don't have people that are educated about what we do and how we do it, then how can they advocate for us in the policy realm? So I think in addition to the things that we're going to cover in the classroom, we've got to think broader than that. My last slide I'll close with is another quote. The illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. And so to me, that's us. Because we're the people that are gonna be teaching. I mean, I'm 52, I could teach another 10, 12 years. And the world has changed a lot since I went to school. So if I'm not willing and able to retool myself and embrace a different way of thinking as I approach the classroom, I'm just further perpetuating the things that we sort of know are already broken. So I'm not giving you like, I hope you weren't expecting a list of go back home and add 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to your class, because that wasn't what I was gonna do today. But I wanted to open up the dialogue about a different way of thinking and approaching problem solving that may lead you to come back with the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that you might add to your course as we move forward. And with that, I'll turn it over to Karl to talk about how we teach.